First, let's get rid of the idea that it's anything goes. You know, we fought very, very hard to make sure that actually the basic principle of state aid, proportionality and non-selectivity, are respected as much as possible. Proportionality is both through ensuring proper remuneration of the state and making sure in the case that for the case of liquidity needs and for the case of recapitalization, that first you don't get too much. And thank you for the CEO of Lufthansa for making a comment going the other way just the day before. And also making sure that the state doesn't stay there too long. So there are lots of, you know, conditions like an increase of the cost of participation over time, interdiction to having too high a pay for the CEO, interdiction from acquisition, limit or interdiction to paying dividend that are there to precisely convince the firm to get out of the deal when they no longer need it. There are also the, in terms of selectivity, we're not as lucky because clearly, given the needs, not everybody's going to get the aid. And of course, you know, politically, who's going to get the aid? Well, usually the big firms and the big employers. And therefore, that, yes, that could have bad effect on the structure that we get after COVID, and that could be long lasting. So, which is why, in the Lufthansa deal, for example, we actually did impose remedy-like condition. We imposed the divestment of slots at the two most congested airports, which is Frankfurt and Munich. Might not be perfect, but at least we insist precisely on having competition remedy because precisely it's not that they've done anything wrong from the point of view of competition. But precisely, we know that the ones that are going to get the help are the ones that, you know, tend to have significant market power. And then, of course, the next stage will be when we get into the recovery to kind of be especially vigilant on mergers and antitrust to make sure that we can restore an acceptable market structure as far as possible, as fast as possible.
Could I comment on this on the protectionism, if I may? I think we have the call for protectionism here already in a very special way. If you look to Norway, for example, there's a slogan saying that you should buy Norwegian products much more than before. So no, it's no buy Norwegian products. If that's really a follow-up of consumer behavior, it means that imported products can lose sales in a dramatic way. And the long-run effect is dramatic, especially for Nordic countries. We are very open economies with a lot of import and exports. So competition in many domestic markets are often driven by foreign firms and their products, for example, in the banking industry. So if really follow up on that kind of slogan, buy Norwegian products, it's a dramatic. And this has to do with competition also, because it's about lowering the number of active firms in the market can be in the long run, and less imports also less could lead to less potential for exports. So this is dangerous, and we as competition agencies should warn against the competitive effect of that kind of movement.
Although, I think this is very pernicious, this effect, because on one hand you can say, oh, you know, you just change the conference of the preference of your people in your country. There's no loss from that. If they really feel they should buy Norwegian, but at the same time, they create this reduced incentive to innovate, on which there is a coordination problem between the consumers. I indulge my taste for local production, and my effect on the innovation incentive is small, so I'm not going to take them into account. So it's really very pernicious, yes.
Yeah, Fiona, I wanted to add something.
Yeah, the American perspective on this is quite different because we have such a large country that mass-produced things are inevitably kind of low quality. And so there is a big, I would say if you can afford it, there is substantial trends now to buy locally. And by locally, we don't mean United States, we mean much closer to your place of living. So for me, a Connecticut farm, for example, or a Vermont dairy or something, and local microbrews and so on. And I think this is part of consumer taste and about the environment, zero KM food, or they want to support their neighbors. I think this is fine. But I think the framing of it really depends on whether it's about your taste or whether it's I am against foreign people or foreign goods. It's not in the US, it's not like that. It's more about I value the creativity of my neighbors, and so I would like to buy clothes that are made by my neighbors rather than clothes in Bangladesh because that makes me feel good. I think this is fine.